There we go. So welcome to this one. We actually decided, you know what? We're back. What do we do straight away? We see Mongolian Heights. We see BCQT. We click, we play. And at the end, you'll end up liking somewhere. That's how that works. Yes. I thought this one would be interesting also because he's up against a guy called Strayobora. That alone warrants actually checking out the video. Ironically, while he's playing as England, someone on Mongolian Heights is playing as a Civ that I would just like infamously relate to Beastie for a long time now. And Beastie, after my time away, he still remained very competitive, sitting in sixth on the leaderboard, 2025. That's right, he's just a few years in the future in terms of ELO score, and he's looking phenomenal right now. I mean, Beastie, always consistently in that top 10, top 20 bracket. I don't feel like I've seen him out of that in a very long time. Remember for a while I've been saying like I think the two big surprises, the most interestingly like talented players for me is like DeMuslim and Beastie, because I think it's very easy for a lot of people to think about, you know, how great the Viper is or how great Hera is, or like these people who have a pedigree in Age of Empires or are an active StarCraft pro. Whereas when you talk about DeMuslim and Beastie, of course, they're retired, they're washed out, right? But they're still proving that they made that choice out of their own will. They could have easily kept going to a certain degree. And just coming into this game and actually being on the high end, I mean, if I recall correctly, when we talk about the, the Winter Championship, which just happened, I think there were some surprises there. I think it was quite interesting to see the switch around when you consider the early tournaments, Marine Lord just dumpstering everyone, and now all of a sudden a AoE 2 player coming in. When we talk about these two, like the Beastie, at least in this situation, I think he was 5th to 8th, right? So he finished just outside of the top 4. That's how numbers work, guys. And I believe DeMuslim, did DeMuslim actually, yeah, so he actually came a lot lower in the end. But I still look to these guys as very talented individuals. You can argue that maybe it's just because they're hard grinding one game while someone like the Viper is playing two different games or Hera's playing two different games, but I think that's like a cheap cop-out. You have to appreciate talent where it is. Beastie with this opening, playing kind of typical England, right? Not going onto the waterfront as we've seen so often. Meanwhile, the Mongolian player, bam! He's already there. So he's going to slap this down, start to push out the fishing boats. This does leave you a little bit vulnerable. The reason being, of course, is that when it comes to playing against England, their first move is to just instantly go feudal, spam out up to about 8 or 9 Lombos, run out, and then give you death by pew-pew, right, from long range. And it's a range that you can't compete with. Now, I think that the Mongols are one of the better civs at dealing with this due to the cheap outposts, right? Used to be, because now they got increased. And I think there's still value in it, though, just because, obviously, for the Mongols, you tend to like have cheap units sitting around that can garrison in, courtesy of the Uvu. And then also later on, it has a secondary effect. But I do appreciate that they made this change. I think the 70 wood cost on the outpost was a little bit scummy and it made Mongols a bit too strong. I still think they are somewhat brutal to face off against. I don't think that this has ended their reign of tyranny by any measurement, but it has at least offset some of this early control. And I think especially in this matchup, it's very beneficial to England, because England, the worst thing you run into are those outposts. Those outposts screw over everything you want to do with your Lombos, especially on choke point oriented maps such as Mongolian Heights. So I do expect the English player to fare a lot better after the recent patch in this type of matchup. And at the moment, BC just poking and prodding Strayobora away. He'll just retreat. Strayobora, by the way, I should probably give reference of where this person is sitting right now. I believe it is, yes, 507th. But they've recently been inflating on the ranking for reasonably well. I think like in the last day or so, they gained 73 ELO. So they're bouncing up. They have a lot of games, 667. Now, I know there has been some questions around whether, like, this change to the matchmaking system is valid. If I recall correctly, the change they made is that it expands the search based on rating quicker than it used to. So people are getting very odd matchups. I definitely would categorize this as one. You've got a top 10 player versus a top 500. And while, you know, while it's close enough that I think Strayobora can somewhat compete, especially playing as the potent Mongols, I think being up against a top 10 player is going to kind of be a ball-crushing experience here. And you can see that the pressure's already feeling. Think about the difference here, by the way. The 30 wood change really has mattered here. How much longer it takes you to be comfortable with pushing out this outpost, and you won't even get it up. The scouts will push him off, and that is going to be a failed attempt at an outpost, and the outpost does go down for Beastie, and now you're in trouble. tech up complete, into the feudal. This is where you can start pushing out these longbows and start spamming hard onto the fishing boat line. The beautiful thing about this outpost is it's always going to have a unit in range for the network of castles, which means you're always going to be able to actually machine gun fire down these fishing boats, meaning you probably only need 5 or 6 to kill off a boat compared to what used to be like 8 or 9 with the healing and the garrisoning factor. Wow, the Khan dying though is very surprising there. So you do get the outpost down, but it costs you a Khan, and this is a very delicate point in the game to lose your Khan. I know it doesn't seem like it, we're only a few minutes in, like don't be a drama queen pigeon, but really losing your Khan around the 5 to 7 minute mark, I think is actually a big deal up against England, because that's when this aggression starts to come out. And now you're immobile against Lombos, which means these Lombos are going to hard pressure you. You're already committed to a Rax, which in my opinion is a fatal error here, and now you're going to be punished for it. Like, what is the purpose of this Rax right now? Right? Like, can anyone explain it? Because I don't have the explanation. I'm meant to be the caster giving you the explanations. So that really kind of sets it in motion of how awkward this is. He's spamming Spearmen now, but Spearmen are counted out by the Lombos, right? So you're just going to take this bonus damage. They're going to be near an outpost that'll attack quicker. You'll never reach them. The only purpose you really have from this building right now is to garrison in the outposts. And you could argue about killing scouts, but here's a thought, guys. If your goal here was to kill the scouts, why not build a stable? Why not build a stable that would give you access to horsemen, which counter the Lombos, but then also scouts that only cost 10 resource more. Oh, sorry, not even 10 resource. No, they cost less, right? They cost 60 food. So they cost less. They just overall cost less. When I say it like that, you do really sit there and go, huh. Yeah, that does seem like a missed trick. Huh. What was he thinking? I mean, maybe he was thinking me stabby, stabby scout, but now me do nothing and nothing else. Like, you can't even fish here. You're seeing the frustration, right? He's being poked and prodded at, and you can even see the Lombos have been chasing these boats upriver. So overall, this is a very uncomfortable situation for Strelbori to be in. And now, this is the problem when you go onto the water up against England, is if you can't defend your initial holdings, you fall into this sunken cost fallacy. So what's happening for Strelbori right now, in his mind, what he's going through is like, I need to defend this dock. I need to keep it alive. I'm going to invest 100 wood here. I'm going to invest 100 wood here. I'm going to invest in more spearmen to garrison these buildings so I have more shots coming out. I'm then going to have to rebuild my fleet, right? And as I start to say these things, if someone's a math person, you're doing the numbers, right? You're adding all this up and you're realizing that this is really not good. It's so much your early economy. And look at the delay. Strelbori took this long to get up to Feudal compared to Beastie. Beastie now already up to 10 Lombos. And look at the frustration here. You get poked. And although it'll take 1,000,001 years to kill off these outposts will eventually die to the Lombos. And you can already see the damage that was being done to this one. And with 10 Lombos, by the way, I should point out, that's just going to like, that's almost going to insta-kill you, right? So 6 damage, so you do 60 pure, right? So 2 salvos and you're almost dead. So there's 1 salvo, another one quickly comes out. With the starter step and the attack rate from the defense, the network of castles, there's no way you're fishing here. It's just wasted resource every time, 75 wood. And he'll finally get a light junk out, but all you have to do is now back up. You back up, you lose 1 Lombo, now you stay out of range, the light junk doesn't do anything. And this is where it just gets awkward. I say that, BC, we'll realize his mistake in the end. And he can still reach the fishing boats, by the way. And you can see it already. He almost kills another one off. So really uncomfortable situation. Meanwhile, look around the back, Beastie. He sneaks in with the scout and the villager. And he's building a back outpost here. And this is worrisome because I don't think he knows. Yeah. It's, oh my god. This one as well, Beastie. This is a beaut right here. You don't see it. Strelbori has no idea about this. He's more boxed in than he realizes, and now the shift across. Beastie, he sees the opening, he makes the crossing, and now he's going straight into your base. And these stables, this is too late. This is too much diversification at this stage in the game. You built a Rax, you built an archery range, and now you built a stable. How are you able to afford the push out of all three of these while still having to rebuild your fishing fleet? I feel like Strelbori has stretched himself too thin, and now he's going to be punished for it. The only good news is that his woodline is on the north side, right? And your opponent's covering the southeast, but he's getting there. You can see the Beastie, the crawl continues. And you don't have counter outposting as easily, remember, because they're 100 wood. They're not 70 wood anymore. Wow, this is actually really well played. And there's no way to make a crossing, right? You haven't got an army to make a crossing. You're going to always be on the defensive. The least you can do is try to block him out of actually bringing more troops across. But what Beastie now has to do is group up another group of like 10 Lombomen and then poke away at these light junks with these crappy range, right? Because remember, They're only four tile range compared to the seven. You can poke, poke, poke. They retreat away, and then you run across again. Maybe he comes back and snipes one or two, but ultimately you're going to get a bunch of the Lombos across. And there we go. Counter outpost did go down over here from Strelbora. It's wonky, though, and you can feel it. There's a gap in the market. And it's going to be exploited. He can actually just run through here. It hasn't been upgraded yet, so he can get another outpost down, and then you're kind of done. Look at this. This is actually beautifully done. So Beastie, look, he gets vision on the villager line via the outpost here, and now he's going to move around the back with this villager to build an outpost that will be able to shoot away at the villager line and starve you off from the resource front. At this point, like, Strelbor has about 3 minutes before he's only getting food, really, right? So we'll have the nearby carcasses which are running out, and they'll have food on the water that he's occasionally getting. But other than that, he's going to be starved, and that's why it's important he gets these horsemen out quick. And I'm not a big fan of the archers, really. I think just horsemen and spam down would have been better. Especially after the buffs, right? Because horsemen now, each rank, they get an additional one range resistance, as you can see there, compared to what they used to have. Minus, of course, the Dark Age. Dark Age ones didn't get that buff. But yeah, just an awkward situation. And now Beastie looking to ramp up the pressure with the rams. Hasn't brought more reinforcements across yet by the looks of it. But, oh, he didn't get the outpost down. Really well played. Strelbora, that was important. If that outpost goes down, this game is already over. So he keeps himself alive, and now he needs to find a way to fight back. He could try to assault onto Beastie's base. I like that idea. But you have to address these rams. I feel like if you're going to make this move, it needed to be a minute or two sooner. So instead, he's going to ride out. But it's problematic, right? The outposts are already in place. Even if you try to rush in, the Lombos have somewhere to hide. And the rams already moving across. You can see him backing up. The chase coming in from Strelbora. Beastie not garrisoning here. He's fully backing up. He's actually giving a lot of respect over to Strelbora. Maybe more than is needed, right? Especially considering he sees the entire army, but he's paranoid about it. And they are riding on. Yeah, this is... Okay, now I'm starting to understand Beastie's thought process here. He's concerned about the Yam, right? That movement speed factor means that you gap close way too quick. So he doesn't want to risk getting completely closed in on by the horseman before he snipes out one or two of them. So actually a pretty kind of cool heads-up play coming out of Beastie that a lot of players wouldn't have done. Like, you saw how I felt about it. Like, maybe just turn, poke, and then get in the outpost. But with so many horsemen coming out, you won't trade efficiently, so instead he's going to give over the outpost. This does hurt, though. It costs you 100 wood, and your opponent's going to get 50 food and 50 gold for burning this crap to the ground, right? So you need to find value elsewhere, and this is what he's doing. He's back on the waterfront. He's walling it up. He's boxing his opponent in, essentially. There we go. So Strelbora. Getting that nice little influx. He'll burn all these down now. And I don't think Beastie's going to invest in trying to protect them. It's just not worth it. It's kind of a sunken cost situation, right? And all these boats are just sunk. So after all that, yeah, you do repel them, but what was the price? You see the ram got some value, got rid of an outpost, is finally going to fall. But the bigger concern for me is that now you've kind of lost control of the waterfront, right? You don't have a quick rush point either. You don't have outpost down to keep the Yam movement speed going. So now you actually have to take a step back and think about your next move. You can't just rush over and, like, use your leveraged advantage of horsemen to punish your opponent. And instead, because Beastie chose to back up, he saves 10 Lombomen, gets them back. Yes, he loses two battering rams, but that buys time with the wall in conjunction for him to build up a few spearmen and now have the answer to the move from Strelbora. And Strelbora, although he has this diversification factor of having all three of the different military buildings, he doesn't have that resource allocation to support it anymore, right? He's still trying to rebuild this fishing fleet, which is just looking more and more pathetic by the day, or by the second in this situation, if we talk real life times. So he has to make this move. And if this move backfires, the game kind of just feels like it just gets out of control, I think. And Beastie, because he has so many spearmen, you can't attack his main army. You have to go through his economy. And his economy might be exposed. Beastie is about to get the heads up. Village is going to be sniped out. He needs to back everyone up right now. But Beastie, he's hanging on here. This could be punished. Movement in. Charge is going to come through. These horsemen, they're not knights, but their pokes and their prods will slowly kill you off. Two villagers dead. They will get a third and they'll back away. A few casualties for it, though. A lot of fire coming your way. This is the power of England. Remember, their buildings, they fire double the amount of arrows out of them. Hence why so many pew-pews were coming flying the way of Team Red. Strelbora just poking and prodding a few. Meanwhile, the ram Oh, it does get through the outpost, but it's going to be burnt down by the reinforcements of Straya Bora. A new outpost does go down from Beastie, but Beastie, he needs to find a way to box his opponent in because he never walled up these sides. There we go. That's the move he's making now. While the fight is going on in his base, he's deciding to actually pinch his opponent and lock him in place. And he's moved to the north and already done it there as well. So Palisades in place. Now Straya Bora has no quick way in to English territory. But Beastie still has to get the remaining Mongols out of his territory is the frustration. He is moving him into a corner. If he wraps around with the spears, you could actually trap him. It's risky because maybe your opponent turns around and attacks the Lombos, but if you want to wipe the army, it's definitely the way to do so. But it looks like it's too late to move that way. Beastie is just going to keep poking and prodding as he chases. And Strelbor, I think this is a mistake to not just fight at this stage. I mean, he doesn't have the info we have, right? We have God Vision. For him, this is his vision. He doesn't know this is now walled up, and that's why he keeps retreating away. He's trying to get his army back out of enemy territory, but he's going to learn the hard way in a few seconds. That's just not possible anymore. Oh, wow. Now this makes even less. So is it just about saving the Khan? This guy's playing some kind of like King's game mode from AoE 2, right? Protect the King! Protect the King!
Murder the King.
Get the king out! Oh god, even the wolves are joining in. And then the bad news arrives. It's like the end of an episode of a Game of Thrones type show. We were betrayed. The Ford Guard didn't hold. And the Khan is dead. Beastie needs to address the center. Strelbora was breaching through there in the meantime. Ram moving in onto the outpost. He's going to set it ablaze. Mooney going the way of the Mongols here. And they will let the outpost fall. No point stopping the ram at that point, considering it's already on fire. You could argue saving 100 wood, but just pushing your opponent all the way back now lets you deal with the ram and then move straight in onto the dock. And look what's being built. It's too late, though. This move from Straya Bora is so greedy because he needed the value on the waterfront. He built into the fishing fleet, which means he doesn't have anything to defend it. And with 16 spearmen, they're going to raise this to the ground in the blink of an eye. And there's nothing you can do. Lombo sniping out your fishing boats one by one. You can't assault this either. There's just too many Lombo, and it feels like over time, Straya Bora, despite his interesting efforts to try and pivot and offset the aggression of Beastie, Beastie has relentlessly built up this Lombo army to a count that he can't match. And it's amazing when you consider how much Straya Bora has, in theory, had ahead of him. Look at his food and gold. He just doesn't spend it quick enough. He doesn't have the infrastructure to do so. I think he was considering a tech up, but now it's going to be too late. Beastie has hit the prime timing. Despite all of the lost rams, the investments back and forth on the outpost, it hasn't hurt him to a point of no recovery. And instead, now he can move in with double ram and an army of 40 Lombomen to slay his opponent's base. And I think this is the detail. This outpost here, if this is allowed to go down, Straya Bora has very little chance of repelling this attack. He's backed up for the moment. And he is building up. Yeah, he's teching up. This is risky, though. Your opponent just shows up with double ram, and you continue the build-up, but you don't have a choice anymore. You're in for a penny, in for a pound. It means you need to buy time, but you don't have the infrastructure to do so. There it is. Castle's reached. Lombo's poking from the side. Spearman holding. Ash is going to fall. Movement in onto the TC. Does he want to commit onto that town center, though? There's a little bit of hesitation trying to bait his opponent in. And you can see it going up. This is the thing. Strelbor has the same info that we have here. He knows this outpost is being constructed. He needs to find a way to stop it, but he can't. And this is a problem. And here's the thing. BC knows everything about his army. This outpost never got scouted. It never got upgraded, right? So it never started shooting with arrow slits. So he's unaware this entire time that there is an outpost that's been snitching on everything he's been doing. And this detail, folks, this is so important. Scout vision is important. Keeping vision of your opponents is such a big deal, and the fact that Beastie gets away with this the entire game has paid dividends for him. Villagers rushing out. Lombos were out of position because they were building more ramps. Charge in, but he's just hesitant. There's just so many Lombos. And the maneuver arrow is used. No! Oh, he knows he has to go. He has no choice anymore. The spears repel him away. The Lombo count is too high. Straya Bora. He has no way of dealing with Baton Rams. His TC down to half HP. He jumps out with some villagers. Chase for again. Lombo's backing up as they start a step far away at the pursuing enemies. But Straya Bora, he's running out of troops. He's running out fast. He's trying to switch into man arms. There's just too many Lombos, though. I'm not convinced that this is going to work. So many idle villagers. So little villagers left. I mean, I say that. He's still got 54. But so little villagers left really gaining anything you need. You need food. And you don't get it anymore because you don't have the dock. You didn't really transition. These pastures came a little bit later. And you can't even gather in front of your TC. And this is the Urar rush. You have to burn these rams right now or you're done. He'll get through them, but you know that Beastie's going nowhere again. He'll just build more of these rams. He's got enough for another one, and there it is, starting to be constructed. Shrailbora not out of the woods yet, but he's holding for the moment, and he's doubling up on the racks, or tripling up, rather. Question is, where's he getting the resources for the man-at-arms? Like I said, these aren't near Anuvu. These pastures, they're delayed on the rate of production, right? So you're in an awkward situation where you just don't have the food output to keep the army churning. Look at it right now. It's at 21. It's going to go up by a bit, but it's not even going to be comparative to what Beastie has. Beastie's still fielding a bigger army and building more units than you are. Even if you have the quality, you just don't have the quantity. Ram will begin his work, and no longer is there an army big enough to quickly rush out and burn this down. You see the problem. Beastie's going to back it up for the moment. Lombos went far away. I see Beastie do this again and again. I don't know if he's doing it to actually fake out his opponent. And there it is. Forces him to come out and play. Insta garrison to try and get away, but so many villagers butchered again. And the spears now chasing through. This lancer play really isn't paying off. He needed more archers, if anything. The problem is the archers just don't handle the longbowmen. Even if they're upgraded, you have to take time to do so, and you can't afford any gaps in your production rates. And it feels like it's almost becoming inevitable at this stage. I mean, you just don't have the resources. And you see Beastie's prepping. As soon as he gets a tech up, this is going to be all but over in his favor, right? Upgraded Lombome in this situation. You can't deal with it. You haven't got enough troops. And more pastures fall in. Pricey losses. More rams being built. That's going to be punished, though. Beastie, big mistake there. Lombo's always out of position, but the White Tower being dropped right next to his base. Come on! You can't do him dirty like that. And that's why he's going to tap out. That's the detail that matters. That's how you do it. Beastie's like, you know what? I got somewhere to be. I don't want to waste any time. Let me give you the download. Let me give you the confirmation that I am teching up. I'm just going to plop this right here in my future base. And you can sign our out, sucker. And that's exactly what happens. I actually love that play, right? Because it genuinely is. It's a really good play from, like, there's no way that your opponent can stop it. So it's just going to pew-pew his buildings and choke him in anyway. It's also a point where you can build siege weapons from. And I think the other cool detail is, like, it really does feel like that kind of flex factor of, like, just to let you know, I'm teching up now. So maybe just GG out and we can both get to our next game 3 minutes earlier. And it kind of, that's what it felt like more to me. It's like Strailbor is like, yeah. Yeah. All right, you get this one. GG, bud. Yeah, he gives it over. Really well played by Beastie to focus on the Docklands. I think if you're playing against England, you really have to be aware of this factor that's going to come out. They will aggress you on the waterfront. England players have got very good at not using the water themselves, but exploiting the fact their opponents do it, right? Lombo timing is very powerful for the English. And Lombos deal with basically anything on the waterfront. There's not many units that can actually reach the Lombo range and actually count them out. So they're always able to poke and prod. And the problem is it's such a sunken investment for you, right? 150 wood to begin with, then 75 wood for each of the food gatherers. And then you need to feel like you've got two returns at least before they get sunk to even feel like it was worthwhile to begin with, right? And the other issue that I find players have is the moment they start investing into these docks, they really do obsessively double down because it's so much your early game economy. It feels like if you try to pivot onto just land within the first 5 minutes of that aggression coming, it feels like you just completely wasted your game. Why did you even bother in the first place? And I think that's the issue that a lot of players fall into. They just need to get more aware of what's going to come out of an English opponent. I think the biggest mistake for me there in that game wasn't the fact that Strailbora built into a dock, it's that he built into a racks. I think the barracks really hurt him in this game and set him far, far back. You're up against England. You know what they're going to do. You know what they're going to do every game. We talked about this so many times before. England, even off the patch, are a very predictable sieve. The opening is very clear, right? It's cut and dry. There's nothing that gets kind of diversified. They're going to put out some Lombos to begin with. And if your answers are spears, then you're in trouble. Really amazing job also by Beastie to snipe out that Khan at the 5 minute mark in the trade. I think that was really good because maybe if that Khan is there, there's a potential move that Strailbor can make where he builds up a few spearmen and he makes a rush play towards maybe the Lombos or some sort of building, or like tries to raid onto your opponent's side of the map and maybe set up some outposts. But unable to do so, really well played by Beastie, proving exactly why he's in the top 10 and Strailbor is only in the top 500. Oh, I went there. I went there. And if you want to see more of me going there, make sure you subscribe on the YouTube side. Make sure you follow on the Twitch side and the Twitter because I might look a little bit older. It's been about a week and a half before I since I uploaded a video. Well, not uploaded, but prepped a video. That's because I was away at a Dota event, which you know if you followed me on all those social medias below.